countrymen and countrywomen, I greet you, Ugandans, and I congratulate you for all the things you have gone through this last year and a half. Have not been easy years, but where we have acted together, we have managed to pull through. You remember last year started with the locusts, started with the floods, started with the floating islands, started with the landslides in the Rwenzori and Mount Elgon, and then we had also the corona. This corona came creeping from different parts of the world, starting with China. However, always being conscious of danger, on the 18th of March, we announced various serious measures, which are all here in these documents. We announced these on the 18th of March, 2020. This was even before we had the first case here in Uganda. The first case was on the 21st of March, but we had already announced the measures on the 18th. After on the 20th, the big movement of the students from the schools had started. Those measures were very serious. They were, let me see how many they were. They were 36 measures, 36 very serious measures. I don't want to go through them because you know them. Now, because of that, we managed to avoid the crisis, to minimize. So we actually controlled the epidemic. There is a graph here which I will, if these people can show it. If you can show it, that graph. That graph there. Those who know anything about graphs, you see how flat it was until about July, when it went up a bit. Then September, it went up a bit. The highest was December 6th, when it went up. That graph was showing, put it back again. That was the December 6th, where it was at the highest, where there were like almost 700 new cases per day. Then it went down and has remained down until now, May. You see, it is now climbing again. So that's why I am here to alert you, to tell you our Uganda proverb, Nantabulirwa yasabana nabwabumba. The one who is not advisable was told that clay does not make boats, for canoes does not make canoes. For him, he said, no, I can make a good canoe out of clay. And he made it, and he put it in the lake, and the man disappeared. Nantabulirwa yasabana nabwabumba. Now, when we had controlled the epidemic, we announced deliberately calculated measures of relaxation. But people, banantabulirwa, the ones who are not advisable, took over now. So we said, abatamivu, the drunkards, the ones who like drinking. We said you could go. No, have we ever opened for the batamivu? Never. For the drunkards, we said no. Because the drunkards, a drunkard is a drunkard. What can you, how can you say, observe this, observe that? That's a contradiction in terms. So Abobo Twabesonyiwa, we forgot about the drunkards. We said, please, Mutuvire, Twagala Kwetasa, we want to survive. But we had opened for others, like the, I think some of the hotels for eating, they could sit as long as they sit properly, distancing. For the churches, please, you can pray, but pray when you are few in number. God is in all places. There is nowhere where it is said that God is in a building. God is omniscient, omnipresent. That's my catechism of 1957. God is in all places. So you don't have to go to look for God in the church if there is a problem there. So we said, only a few people can go to the church or to the mosque. Then when you are traveling, you travel few in a vehicle which is supposed to carry 20, it carries a smaller number. Then we, the schools, we only opened for the completers, the ones who were finishing the transitional classes. And the calculation was that because they are few, they can sit in a scattered way. In a big school which is supposed to be for 1,000, they are now only 200. We thought they could sit in a safe way. Then don't congregate in towns. But people now forgot completely. Put on masks. I have my mask here. I just removed it because these people are fine and they have their masks on. I have my mask here. I have it here. I just removed it because these people are a bit far away. So we, all those measures were put in place were ignored. The other day I was alerting the Speaker of Parliament, the Right Honorable Jacob Oulanyah. and his deputy, Anita Mong. I hear that our young MPs are busy fundraising, what cheap popularity. Stop that. You are endangering people. You are endangering yourselves, also endangering our people. This is not time for fundraising and guest of honor and I don't know what. So, as I told you, when I was being sworn in at Kololo, I told you that when we vaccinate 4.8 million people, then we can relax. That was our calculation that time, but I don't even know whether that is a correct one now, for reasons I will tell you later. And by the 4.8 million people we are talking about, we are talking about the people above 50 years of age, who are 3.3 million. We are talking about teachers, government and private, who are 550,000. We are talking about the security personnel, who are 250,000. And we are talking about the people below 50, but who have got other sicknesses like cancer, like blood pressure, like this sukari, diabetes. Those ones, we said, let's vaccinate these. At that time, the assumption was that those are the ones who are vulnerable. But now, I'm now being seeing the records here that actually the people who are being infected are the young ones. The ones between something and 30, some young people are the ones who are being infected. So when we meet, I'm just here to alert you, but we are going to have a full-scale National Task Force meeting on Wednesday. We shall discuss all this and then we shall advise you. But I just came today because I didn't want to lose more days to alert you that Wanange, you people, Nantaburwa, Yasabarana Wabumba. That's why I came today to warn you. So at that time, the calculation, the thinking was that because the people who had been vulnerable were the elderly people. The strategy was, if you vaccinate those, then the young ones, even if they get the disease, they would defeat it. But I will come to that later. But where we stand now, by today, let me see the situation. Where we stand today alone, we recorded 690 cases in one day. 690 new cases in one day. And the cumulative figure since the whole thing started is 46,623 since last year when the whole problem started. The people who have recovered are 43,401. The death today, the figure was 362. Of course, this is low by the world standards, but you know we don't want anyone of us to die from this avoidable problem. just because of people not listening. But the situation is not yet too bad if we really wake up. Somehow God likes us. God likes Uganda. There must be some reason. Before there is a graph here showing the country. Show that on the TV. The spread of the disease, the geographical spread of the disease, show it to them. There is something here. The geographical spread, show it to them. If you have it, geographical spread, where the corona is found and where it is not found. Do you have it or you don't have it? I have it here. It shows that much of the country, there is no corona. Because the blue, when you see, they should get this map and show it to you. It was in the brief I got from Musenero. Where they are blue, that means there is no case reported. And where there is white, there is that's 1 to 5. And where there is yellow, it is 6 to 25 people. Now, in the map which I have here, which they will show you later when they get it, is that the whole of the western side is blue. There are no cases. The whole of Eastern and Victoria, there are no cases or very few cases. The cluster of cases is somehow in the northeast. I think towards Karamoja there is some presence there. But the purple is Kampala Wakiso. That's where you have 800 to 831. So therefore, Ugandans who are in the villages, don't come if you are not doing serious work, if you are not trading, don't come to Kampala. Don't come to Wakiso. Stay in your villages. Because your villages are safe, it is Kampala and Wakiso that are full of corona, because people don't listen. So if you are not a trader, you are not don't come to see your children, you postpone all that. Stay where you are, because where you are, it is safe. They will show you that map once they get it. Now, these new viruses, there it is. You can see there. All that blue is safe. No corona. Even the yellow, few numbers. The purple, The purple there, that's your Kampala, your Wakiso. This is where there is abundant corona. Because Nantaburirwa, Yasabarana Wabumba, there you are. So please, people, stop this coming to Kampala. And Wakiso, just stay in your villages. Now, these new infections are quite serious. Like, for instance, the new cases, you find that the ones who are asymptomatic were 5. The ones who were mild, 59. Severe, 59. Moderate, 21. Critical, 9. This was on one of the days when this analysis was. That was on the 25th of May. The ones who were analyzed. The mild were 59. This is not percent, but the numbers. The asymptomatic were 6 or 5. Moderate, 21. Severe, 59. Critical, 9. So these new variants are more serious than the old one, the one from China. And these variants they are different clans. Let me see the clans. Ugandans like clans, so you now have the clans of the virus. There is the South African clan, B1351. This is mostly from the drivers from Kenya. There is the UK clan, B117. Mostly from the truck drivers from Kenya. Nigerian, B1525. Some from truck drivers and others, other Kampala, and also in Mulago. There is the Indian one, B1616, brackets, VOC, whatever it means. One patient was in Mulago. 4 other patients in Jinja were travelers from India. So all these groups are now here. And they are very serious. That's why they are affecting children. That's why they are affecting children. And from the school report, let me look at the school report. School report even a student died when we opened the schools for the completers. From October 15th, to March, we had only 239 cases in the schools. But recently, 803 cases have been confirmed in the schools, and one of them died. This runner was in a health training unit. So therefore, this disease, we have got new types of the same virus, and it is more aggressive, more dangerous, and it affects also the young people. Now the hospitals, our success last year, why we didn't lose many people, was that the few that would get sick, you see, the whole strategy hinges on minimizing the infections. That's why we succeeded last year. In Europe and America and other places, they failed because they didn't minimize the numbers. They have much better health facilities than us, but because they failed to control the numbers, those high-grade health facilities were of no value. They were just overwhelmed, and people died in big numbers. You can imagine in the United States of America, I think almost 600,000 people died. 600,000 people is like the whole district of Ntungamo. So it's one of the big districts of Uganda now. You can imagine all the Ntungamists dying. And in other places, Brazil, India, even the European countries, the big problem was they didn't control the numbers, the infections. And this is where we are heading if we don't stop. This is where we are heading. So when people die in big numbers, don't say that we didn't tell you. In India, the Indians also have the additional problem of burning dead bodies. They had a problem of even the firewood, how to burn those dead bodies. So this is what we are looking for here. We are looking for big number of death. Because if you don't control the numbers, then the health facilities cannot cope. Last year and early this year, because the numbers were few, the medical staff could concentrate on them and really take care of them, and then they recover. That's why the recovery rate was very high, because there were few and they could be looked after in a concentrated way. One of my people last year told me that a case sometimes, I think it was the federal Entebbe hospital, told me that to care for one person until he is out, sometimes it took 21 days. One of my doctors told me like that. But if you have got many people, how will you concentrate on many people for 21 days? And where are the hospital beds? We have included the hospital beds. There are many now. But if the numbers are too many, these hospital beds will be overwhelmed. I think now, let me see the hospital beds. Mm. in this report somewhere. We now have got more facilities, but still, if the numbers are too many, they will be overwhelmed. So therefore, when we speak next week after our national task force, we shall go into the details of the do's and the don'ts. And when we do that, I expect everybody to cooperate. I was trying to see where these medical centers, they were in one of the reports. Now, apart from the avoidance measures, the real solution is in the vaccine. When the crisis started, various centers started developing vaccines. One of the other ones was Oxford University, which developed a vaccine known as AstraZeneca, and then they contracted India to make the vaccine. And we bought some doses from there. We bought 964,000. And 581,000 people have been vaccinated with that, which is half dose. They need to do it again. But the problem is that when the crisis in India deepened, then India stopped exporting the vaccine. Well, this is unfortunate on the one hand, but it is also good on the other hand. It is unfortunate because it undermines international confidence in cooperation. I think the Indians should find a better another way of handling this, because I had had the same problem here. When the crisis started, there was only one factory apparently in East Africa, which was manufacturing sanitizers. And this was in Jinja, because of your Waraji, the one which kills some of you, apparently is good, because it can also kill the viruses. It can kill the viruses. If you purify it more, then it becomes a sanitizer. So the water drinkers undergo a lot of organ sanitization inside there. You can imagine if the water can kill the this dangerous virus, what it does to your to your liver. Ugandans are really so anyway, because of that abundance of waraji, apparently we were the only ones making sanitizers when this crisis started. Because you refine it more. When you refine it more, you get a fertilizer. You get a sanitizer. So somebody said, because we need sanitizers here, we should not export. I said, rubbish, I don't want to hear that. You cannot say that because I am in danger and my neighbor is also in danger, whatever literal help that there is, I should monopolize it. It's not correct. It's not wise to do that. So what I told our people was no. What you do, you say 40% is for us here, but we share the 60% with our brothers in East Africa. And that's what we did. So I would appeal to the ones who have these vaccines now to look at that approach. Yes, you can see how you keep, but you cannot say, let those die. I only care about mine. If you do that, then you can be sure that tomorrow I will never trust you. You can be sure about that. So this is very tricky for the globe. And of course, for me, an African nationalist, I'm not very happy, but I am able to turn to my people who believe in dependency and say, did I not tell you? I'm able now to tell them that. Did I not tell you? That's what I was telling this Mr. Ponciano, our professor of virus. Because that virus center is always busy collaborating with others. So I was asking him, are you collaborating or are you being used? There's a difference between collaboration and being used. So because of that, we are working very hard also to develop our own vaccine. But of course, this will take a bit of time. And we are also working on some other solutions. Our people are working on them. But let's first concentrate on prevention. We are discussing with the other groups, the Johnson & Johnson, the vaccine which they have. And Cuba. The Pfizer one, the one of the Americans apparently is difficult because of the refrigeration. It needs high refrigeration, which the others don't need so much. So therefore, I came today to sound a warning to the whole country that we are entering a very dangerous phase. After our meeting on Wednesday, we are going to give a detailed guidelines, and which will have to be enforced. Of course, I'm also told that these policemen are corrupt. That when we say enforce guidelines, they also misuse them. But that's curable. We are going to arrest them. I will put my agents in the population. And those who are corrupt, we shall get them and really treat them severely. But more importantly, I appeal to the population, without waiting for these guidelines to be repeated again, because you already know them. Putting on the mask, social distancing. If you don't have to go to travel, don't travel, just stay in your homes. Sanitize your hands. Don't touch your mouth. Don't touch your eyes. Don't touch your nose with unclean hands. These are the measures that helped us to overcome this problem. toward the end of next week, I will make another broadcast and give a detailed way forward. If we manage to get enough doses and vaccinate the 5 million, five million or so, then we shall see what happens to the young people. Because the old strategy was vaccinate the old, the young will be all right. But now, it seems that's not the case, especially with these new variants. Shall we have to work to vaccinate the whole society before we relax or what? That one we are going to debate and decide on. I thank you and I wish you good luck.